Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I welcome all of you to this Qur'an introduction class. And in this series of lectures, we are looking at the Qur'an, how it was revealed, how it was collected, how it was compiled in a book form that we know today. Now, we are going to see a very interesting lesson in this series, the collection of the Qur'an. The chapter's name is the collection of the Qur'an, and the learning objective of this lesson is to know how the Qur'an was preserved and collected after it was revealed to the Prophet. The first section in this chapter is the era of the Prophet, 609 to 632 CE. That is the 23 years of prophethood. As you know, the Quran was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, gradually, section by section, in a period of 23 years. Whenever the need arose, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to instruct the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to reveal the Quran, he would order Jibreel to take sections of the Quran, verses of the Quran, and convey it to the Prophet, peace be upon him. The second part of this chapter is preservation of the Quran. When Jibreel Amin first appeared to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and began reciting the verses of the Quran, the Prophet was concerned as to he shouldn't lose any verses, he shouldn't miss out any verses of the Quran. So he was reciting after Jibreel word by word hastily. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eased this problem. He instructed the Prophet to just listen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the responsibility of collecting the Quran in the Prophet's heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 16 to 18, Allah says, "Do not move your tongue to hastily learn it. Surely I will collect and recite it. So when I recite it, follow it." This was very important because human beings are prone to error, can make mistakes. So this very important aspect of revelation, that is the Prophet remembering exactly what was revealed, this responsibility was taken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And it becomes more important when we know that the Prophet couldn't read or write. So he had to remember the Quran exactly as it was revealed, which was taken care by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet passed all the Quran before he passed away. Whatever was revealed to him, the Prophet, peace be upon him, passed on to his companions, his Sahaba. And he used a number of different ways to make sure that his companions, the Muslims, memorized the Quran and recorded it exactly how they heard from the Prophet. And he used a number of different ways. The first way was the Prophet used to recite aloud parts of the Quran, surahs or verses of the Quran in the daily congregational prayers, the salahs. And many Muslims praying after him used to listen to the Quran. In this way, his followers used to hear parts of the Quran daily. A very interesting thing here mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, hadith number 1893 and 1894. Umm Hisham bint Harisah radiyallahu anha reported that she memorized Surah Kaf simply from hearing the Prophet recite it during the khutbas on Friday. The second way of making sure that people memorized and recorded the Quran was everyone who entered Islam would be taught parts of the Quran so that they could use it in their daily prayers. As soon as a person accepted Islam, he was taught the Quran. He was taught some surahs, some verses of the Quran, so that they may recite it in their daily prayers. Thus, Muslims were always learning and teaching various parts of the Quran. This was the second way. Third way, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed his followers, "Khairakum man ta'allama al-Qur'ana wa 'allamahu." The Prophet informed that the best of them, the best of the Muslims, were those who learned and taught the Quran. This encouraged the Muslims to make even greater efforts to memorize the Quran and teach it to others. This was the third way. The fourth way was those who were able to read and write were told by the Prophet to write down the various sections of the Quran. A few companions knew how to read and write, and they were instructed by the Prophet to write down the various sections of the Quran as they were revealed. The guidance about the order of the surahs, the order of the verses, which verse should be after which verse, which surah should be before which surah, everything was instructed by the Prophet, peace be upon him. Al-Bara ibn Azib radiyallahu anhu stated that when the verse, "Those believers who sit at home are not equal to those believers who strive in the way of Allah." And this verse is mentioned in Surah An-Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 95. So when this verse was revealed, the Prophet said, "Call so and so." And that person came with an ink pot and a wooden board or a shoulder blade. As you know, there was no writing material, paper at that time. The Prophet said, "Write, those believers who sit at home are not equal with those who strive in the cause of Allah." And the person wrote it. So this way, the Quran was memorized by the Muslims and even written down in the lifetime of the Prophet. Another important point here is because there was no paper in Arabia at that time, the Quran was written down on anything that was available. The companions wrote the Quran on date palm leaves, flat stones, tree bark, wood, dried animal skins, and even the shoulder blades of sheep and camels. Thus, the verses of the Quran were preserved in the hearts of the Muslims as well as written down. Since people entered Islam at various points during the Prophet's mission, only a few heard all of the Quran directly from the Prophet. For example, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he accepted Islam much later. Some companions were able to memorize better than other companions. Now, the point here to stress is, although different Sahaba knew the different parts of the Quran, the point here is that the Quran in its entirety was, in its complete form, was memorized by different people. And even it was written down, although by different people and different sections and on different writing materials. Now we are coming to the third section of this lesson. The Quran just after the Prophet, peace be upon him's death. Okay. When the Prophet died in the year 632 CE, the whole of the Quran was not written down in one complete book form. Okay. As I said, different sections were memorized by different Sahaba. Different sections of the Quran were written on different writing materials by different Sahaba. The point here is because of the fact that the verses of the Quran were continuously being revealed up to just before the Prophet's passing away, the Sahaba were busy in recording and memorizing the verses. So they didn't find time to compile the verses, compile the surahs in one book form. Section number 4 of this lesson, the era of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, 632 to 634 CE, corresponding to the 11th and 13th year after Hijrah. So now we saw the era of the Prophet, peace be upon him, how the Quran was preserved, how the Quran was memorized, how the Quran was written down. Now after the Prophet's passing away, the era of Abu Bakr starts. Okay, so what happened in this era, we'll see. After the death of the Prophet, there arose three main groups opposed to Islam in the Arabian Peninsula. The first group was made up of those who decided that they will not give the zakah. They thought that they were obliged to give the zakah as a tax to the Prophet, peace be upon him, because he had conquered their lands. But when the Prophet passed away, they thought that they didn't have that, you know, they didn't have to pay the zakah. And they collected all, they gathered all such groups who didn't want to pay the zakah, and they were about to attack Medina, the center of Islam. The second group was those who had entered Islam in order to escape defeat. The munafiq, they couldn't fight Islam face to face. When Islam grew into a great military power, they couldn't fight Islam. So now this group did not believe in Allah and His Messenger at all. They didn't believe. They wanted to destroy Islam so they could be free to do as they please. Now when Islam comes, you have to offer salah, you have to pay the zakah, and then you go have to go for Hajj pilgrimage, then you have to observe fasting in the month of Ramadan, then you don't have to take interest, then you don't have to have intoxicants, you know, many things. So they thought that if we destroy Islam, we are free to do what we want to do. Okay, so this group joined the first group. This group joined the first group. So the armies of those who refused to pay zakah appeared strong at that time. So the hypocrites joined the first group. The third group was made up of a number of false prophets and prophetesses, you know, male prophets and female prophets, those who were, you know, liars. In Najd, in the region of Yamama, an Arab from the tribe of Banu Hanifa named Musaylima claimed prophethood. Okay. In the southern part of Arabia, another Arab from the tribe of Ans called Al-Aswad claimed prophethood, and he took over Najran and Yemen. In northern Arabia, a woman called Sajah from the Banu Tamim tribe also claimed prophethood and rose in arms against the Muslim state. These false prophets invited people to leave Islam by claiming that Allah had revealed new laws to them, making allowable most of the things which were forbidden by Allah through Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now the true Muslims under Caliph Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu were forced to fight these three groups. And this played a very important part in the collection of the Quran. How? Inshallah, we'll see. Many of those who had memorized large portions of the Quran were killed. The Muslims who knew much of the Quran, most of the Quran, maybe a few complete Quran, they knew the reward of striving in the way of Allah, and they were in the forefront of the battles, and they were, you know, they were martyred in a huge number. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu realized the danger of what was happening. So he goes to the Caliph Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and he suggests that the whole Quran should be written down in one book in order to preserve it. So he first refused, but afterwards he realized that this was not an innovation in religion. What the Prophet started, that he instructed the Sahaba to write down the verses and surahs of the Quran, this was just compilation of those written material. This was the completion of the work that the Prophet had started. This was not a new thing in Islam. So after a while, he realized that Umar's advice was correct and he ordered that the copy of the Quran should be written down. And he ordered Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu to be in charge of collecting and writing down the whole Quran in one book form. Oh, he was Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu was the team leader. Okay, but even Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu refused to do this because of the same reason as Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had refused. But even he realized that this was not an innovation in religion, but this was the completion of the work which the Prophet had started. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu chose Zayd ibn Thabit as the team leader, and why was he chosen? The first point about Zayd radiallahu anhu was he was one of the best reciters of the Quran, and this is mentioned in Al-Itqan, volume number 1, page number 199. Second point, he was one of the few who had memorized the whole Quran during the lifetime of the Prophet. Third point, he was one of those whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked to write down the Quran. So whenever verses were revealed to the Prophet, peace be upon him, the Prophet would call Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu to write down the verses which were revealed. Fourth point, Zayd ibn Thabit was one of the few who were present when the Prophet, peace be upon him, recited the whole Quran during the last Ramadan of his life. He was with the Prophet and he heard the Quran in its order, in its entirety, from the Prophet himself. And that is why he was chosen as the team leader to collect and compile the Quran in one book form. Zayd began the process by collecting all the written material on which the Quran was written. He then gathered around him all of those who had memorized all of the Quran or large portions of the Quran. And then he compared what was written down with what he and others had memorized. He would take the written material on which the verses were written and he would check with his own memorization and the different Sahaba's memorization. He would check it. And if all agreed, he would then write it down on pages of leather. In this way, the whole Quran was written down during the reign of the first caliph, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. The whole Quran was written on leather pages and compiled in one book form, right? Just before his death, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu turned over the Quran to Umar radiallahu anhu. He gave this copy of the Quran to Umar radiallahu anhu. And just before his death, he passed on this copy to his daughter Hafsa, who was even the widow of the Prophet, peace be upon him. Hafsa radiallahu anha kept the Quran in her house in Medina, but she made it available to anyone who wanted to make copies from it or check the accuracy of what they had memorized. Now we come to the fifth section of the lesson, the era of Usman radiallahu anhu. We have seen the era of the Prophet, we have seen the era of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, then we have seen the era of Umar radiallahu anhu. Now the Musaf, the copy is with Hafsa radiallahu anha. And now we are coming to the era of Usman radiallahu anhu, 644 to 656 CE, corresponding to 23 to 35 after Hijri, the 12 years. Usman radiallahu anhu is now the Khalifa, the Amirul Mumineen. Now during the reign of Caliph Umar, the Islamic state had expanded beyond the borders of Arabian Peninsula. Egypt, Syria, Iraq were conquered. Now even in Caliph Usman's reign, this expansion continued into Persia, India, Russia, China, Turkey, and across North Africa. Many of the people of these regions accepted Islam and learned the recitation of the Quran from the early Muslims. Now, the problem of non-Arabs learning the Quran and reciting was felt. The Quran was revealed in 7 different dialects. For example, we have UK English, different from US English, then, you know, this way. So, the different dialects were there, and the Quran was revealed in 7 different dialects, and people were, you know, people began reciting in the 7 different dialects. They were free to do so at that time. Now we come to the 6th section of the chapter. The second writing. The first writing was at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Zayd ibn Thabit was the team leader. Now we come to the second writing. And as I said, now some Arabs began to boast that their dialect was superior to other dialects. And they began to boast, they began to fight. Now new Muslims began reciting the Quran. They were non-Arabs. Arabic was not mother tongue. And they were reciting, and people were confused that even if they made mistakes, the mistakes were not recognized. This was a great confusion, and the danger was that the Quran may be changed by the people. So these problems eventually became a source of confusion in the Muslim provinces outside of Arabia. One of the Sahaba by the name of Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu. Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu noticed the confusion while he was in Iraq and feared that it might lead to a breakup of the Muslim nation and changing of the Quran. The people were fighting, people were arguing. On his return to the capital Medina, he informed Caliph Usman of what he had heard and seen. Usman radiallahu anhu realized the danger. He called a meeting of the major Sahaba and he asked them, what should we do? How should we find a solution to this problem? So they decided to make official copies of the Quran from the one compiled in Abu Bakr's time and limit the people to its recitation. So in this way, when the dialect is same, all people recite in a single dialect, there would be no confusion. Usman radiallahu anhu asked Hafsa radiallahu anha for the original copy and again called on Zayd ibn Thabit to head a committee of 4 Quranic scholars who would take on the task of making official copies. So this team made official copies, a total of 7 copies. And these copies were sent, one to Makkah, another to Syria, another to Basra, another copy to Kufa, one to Yemen, one to Bahrain, and one was kept in the capital, Medina. Okay? And Usman radiallahu anhu sent an official reciter of the Quran with each copy in order to clear up any confusion, any problem which may later arise. So he instructed, this is the official copy of the Quran and this is the official dialect, the dialect of the Quraysh. He also ordered that all the other copies of the Quran be destroyed, as people had made notes on their personal copies and some copies were incomplete. Now what happened? That there were many copies of the Quran, although a few surahs, some verses, you know, many materials on which the Quran was written still with the people in Medina, which were not checked by Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu. So maybe those unchecked copies may contain some mistakes. For example, as a teacher, there are 10 students and the teacher checks the answers, the notebook of 8 students. And he, you know, points out the mistakes and corrects it. Now, there are 2 students whose copies, they have written the same answers, but which are not checked by the teacher. So, they might contain some mistakes, right? So Usman radiallahu anhu ordered that all such materials on which the Quran was written, which were not checked, should be destroyed, should be burned. And this gave this gave an opportunity for the enemies of Islam to say that Usman radiallahu anhu destroyed the original Quran, and now what you have is the copy of Usman. This is not the Quran as was revealed to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So this gave an opportunity to the enemies of Islam. But the answer to this misconception is that Usman radiallahu anhu ordered those materials, those copies of the Quran, to be destroyed which were not checked. And he said, now if you want to make any copy, now if you want to write any part of the Quran, now if you want to memorize any part of the Quran, you should do so from the official copy. And this copy is known as Mushaf Usman. Right? So this was how the Quran was preserved. In this way, the Quran was saved from any kind of change or loss. This process was completed in the year 646 CE, 2 years after Usman became the new caliph. So in this way, the Quran was preserved, it was written down, it was memorized, and now even the official copies of the Quran were there, the official recitation was there in the dialect of the Quraysh. So the Quran was saved in its entirety, in its complete form. So today in the world we find that the Quran is exactly same. You go anywhere in the world, the Quran in Arabic is same. All the verses, all the surahs in perfect order. So this is another miracle of the Quran. So share the khair, tell others, tell your friends, and the next chapter we will do is the Quranic text. Order of the verses and chapters. So remember me in duas. Waakhir dawana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.